It's called The City Different, and Santa Fe is truly like nowhere else. Laying at the foot of New Mexico's Sangre de Cristo Mountains, this old town is a place where the street names recall 400 years of real history. A small city of just 60,000 people, Santa Fe is many things at once: a culinary capital, an artist's mecca, an Indian marketplace. But if it is nothing else, it is one of a kind. Santa Fe is the oldest capital city in America, and at 7,000 feet, it is also the highest. It has become a boom town over the last decade, more than 1 million visitors a year, tourists, drawn here by the superb mountain vistas, the old world feel, and the cultural sophistication. Many who came stayed. For 35 years, Joe Day endured New England winters and banged around Boston as a television street reporter. In 1993, he and his wife moved to Santa Fe. Guess what? They're not coming back.
I feel more relaxed here. I mean, I'm busy. I'm teaching at a couple of schools, and I'm a student paper advisor at a college here, and I do some stuff for public TV and newspapers. But it's more at my own pace. You know what I mean? I think I wore a tie once in 1997. People have asked me, you know, would you go back to Boston, right? I guess if somebody offered me, you know, $50 million to pitch for the Red Sox, I would consider going back to Boston. But short of that, I think we'll stay here.
In Santa Fe, Southwest cuisine is a cult, and the little red chili pepper is God. You can see them hanging all over town, even in the ice cream parlors. Bite into the wrong one of these babies and you'll feel like you just put 100 killer bees in your mouth. Rachel Alvarez has been selling chilies on a Santa Fe street corner for 25 years. She sends them regularly to her son in Boston.
Well, he loves to make salsa with that.
I bet he makes the best salsa in Brookline.
I bet you he does. His co-workers don't believe the kind of salsa that he makes. It's hot, but they like it.
You won't have a hard time finding a place to eat in Santa Fe. If you took away all the fast food joints, you would still have 200 restaurants to choose from. Not bad for a town the size of Waltham. Food is an art form here. Where else could you order up crab and mango on tortilla spaghetti with habanero chili sour cream sauce? If you don't know the difference between pozole and poblano, not to worry. You can learn about the whole enchilada in classes at the Santa Fe School of Cooking. Susan Curtis started the school 8 years ago.
We run cooking classes 5 to 10 times a week. We get people who want to know what are these things that are on the menus in the restaurants. This cooking school tries to mirror the food in this area. So we do very traditional cooking, from tortillas, tamales, enchiladas, but also we reflect the more contemporary trend-setting restaurants.
Looking to spice up that bland New England dinner? In the school's store, you can stock up on herbs and spices you'd be as likely to find as moon rocks in other parts of the country. My favorite? Epazote, which helps eliminate, well, how should I say, the sometimes noisy and noxious side effects of eating beans. Susan's daughter, Nicole, manages the store.
So I put this in the Boston baked beans, stir it in, I eat the Boston baked beans, and the old limerick no longer applies. Beans, beans, the musical fruit, the more you eat, the more you toot. This makes the toots disappear?
Should work for you.
I tell you what, I'll take 200 cans. Nicole, you know what you've just done? You've saved my marriage. Thank you very much. If I can find a place to take care of the smell of a cigar, man, it's a whole new ballgame.
The Santa Fe tourist boom has drawn new businesses to town, like the Auto Body Express. But this place is not about buffing cars. Owner Fred Imus is going retail.
For years, he has sold everything from denim jackets to salsa and chips in a mail-order business phenomenon. Of course, it helps when your brother is Don Imus, and he shamelessly plugs your products on his morning radio show to an audience of millions.
It is 6 minutes after the hour, and I am Imus in the morning. Joining us now for the national news, world events, and all that, live from Santa Fe, New Mexico, is my brother, Fred Imus. Good morning, Fred.
Good morning. I'm holding Barnacle hostage. I want $300 and a bus ticket to Phoenix, or I'm going to blow his ass away.
Is that a real gun you're holding on him, Fred?
It's my .357.
Is it loaded?
Is it loaded?
I don't know. I thought I unloaded it, yeah. But I'm not sure. I don't have anything against Barnacle, but he was handy.
What's your biggest domestic market, do you think?
Boston. I love those people in Boston. I love the Boston, Cardinals? No, Red Sox. They're my favorite team, the Red Sox.
Yeah. What's your favorite football team, Fred?
New England, Patriots.
Figures, yeah.
You know?
In exchange for all the radio publicity, Fred takes extremely good care of his brother's Jeep.
He thinks I keep a cover on it and it's always clean.
Yeah. What he doesn't know is, I mean, he's a joke.
Yeah, right. He's like, I mean...
He's a fool.
I can tell him anything on the phone. I say, hey, the Jeep's in my garage covered up.
Yeah.
You know, we take a duster and dust it every day.
Yeah, well, we won't put your brother's Jeep on TV because it is a mess.
Well, it got a little dirty, you know.
Yeah. That's very disturbing. Ooh, he'd be very upset.
He'd be very unhappy, wouldn't he?
Yeah, he would be. He's never going to see it, though, on TV.
He's not going to see it
like that. No.
Oh, as long as you can assure me that it's not going to be on TV, well, that's fine.
Fred?
I'm comfortable with that.
Between you, me, and Connie Chung, that's never going to be on TV.
Santa Fe's tourist explosion comes with a price. The narrow streets around the plaza are often choked with visitors, and finding parking can be a fantasy. Commercial rents have skyrocketed. Woolworth's is out. Banana Republic and The Gap are in. Many locals feel this boutique invasion threatens to turn the city into a Disney-fied version of itself. Author Susan Hazen Hammond is a longtime observer of the Santa Fe scene.
When I first came, there were still a lot of family stores on the plaza. It was the heart of the city. But as more people have come in from the outside, as tourism has skyrocketed, all those stores have given way to mainly galleries and touristy kinds of things.
Reader's polls regularly rate Santa Fe as one of the top tourist destinations in the world, beating out places like Paris, San Francisco, and Venice. A decade of fawning national publicity about Santa Fe chic brought in the BMW crowd. Home prices quadrupled. Now, averaging about $200,000. Never mind that the average local income is still only $16,000 a year. Many longtime residents feel priced out.
Here's one that they ask around the plaza. How many Santa Feans does it take to screw in a light bulb? The answer is 7. 1 to screw it in, and 6 to stand around moaning that the old one was better.
Santa Fe is probably the only city in America where the more money you have, the more likely it is that you live in a mud house down a dirt road, available in a choice of 2 stylish colors, brown and light brown. Adobe homes are de rigueur for chic Santa Feans. $55,000 Range Rovers are also in vogue, because Lexuses won't handle as well in the snow. Debbie Jaramillo grew up in Santa Fe and is now the town's mayor. She's probably the only mayor in America who wants less money flowing into her town from outsiders.
Santa Fe has been marketed all over the world. Really promoting Santa Fe as a chic place, you know, this is where the trendy people want to be, and it brought a lot of people. The people targeted were wealthy people. The foothills got inundated with what I call trophy homes. A lot of wealth came into the community, and very little, if nothing at all, was done to deal with the people who were living here, who were already here. We are today trying to deal with still our popularity, but what I'm doing different than before is I'm paying attention to the people who live here too. So I think you can do both, you just have to balance them.
Today, the legendary Santa Fe lifestyle means picking up the New York Times and Wall Street Journal right on the street. Your cab driver might be a PhD from Columbia. Your waiter, a Broadway singer.
Get your kicks on Route 66.
This is La Casa Seña, a small restaurant in downtown Santa Fe. Between taking your drink order and delivering your dessert, the wait staff dishes up songs some of them have performed on Broadway. They traded the Great White Way for the Good Life in Santa Fe. Greg Grissom is the restaurant's manager and a singer himself.
They want to come here and raise their families. People wander in off the street. They might not even know that they're walking into a cabaret. It's kind of fun to watch. People are can be very reserved, and yes, I'll have this and the duck, and where's my wine? Could you get that right away? And then all of a sudden you're up there belting out a song, and they're like utter amazement. And no one's expecting to see the quality of singer or the quality of entertainer that we've put together.
Santa Fe is one of the most concentrated art markets in the world. Retail art sales reach $200 million a year. Some of the artwork here is very good and very expensive. Some is very bad and also expensive. It is hard to step outside without seeing a store, a gallery selling art. No self-respecting retailer in Santa Fe would call their place of business a store.
There are, in fact, a lot of artists and a lot of art galleries here, probably close to 300. Santa Fe is very unique. It is a small city with very big city amenities. It has extraordinary light, for one thing. It has the mountains surrounding us. It has world-class sunsets, glorious sunsets. The air is clear. It's a very magical place to live. And so artists are quite naturally attracted here.
Art in Santa Fe is democratic. There is a little something for everyone. In the portico of the Palace of Governors, you can buy Pueblo Indian jewelry from dozens of local artisans. North of the city, the Ortega family has been creating woven works of art for 8 generations. David Ortega began weaving blankets for the family business 60 years ago.
I started weaving after high school in 1936. It has been continuously in the family. The designs are created by the individual weaver. They do not copy any other weaver. Each one is an original.
Georgia O'Keeffe is the patron saint of the arts in Santa Fe. O'Keeffe spent the last 4 decades of her life in this area and drew her inspiration from it. "I paint flowers big," she said, "so that people would notice." They noticed. Her red poppies have become a postage stamp. Her desert bleached bones have become American icons. O'Keeffe did not change the way America looked. She changed the way America saw.
I grew up pretty much as everybody else grows up and found myself saying to myself, "I can't live where I want to. I can't go where I want to. I can't do what I want to. I can't even say what I want to." I decided I was a very stupid fool not to at least paint as I wanted to. That was nobody's business but my own.
O'Keeffe described painting as filling a space in a beautiful way. And the Georgia O'Keeffe Museum, which opened in the summer of 97, could be said to do just that. The museum was modeled after O'Keeffe's famous home north of the city and is filled with more than 100 of her works.
Well, O'Keeffe said about the landscape that it was as if half the painting was done for her. It was absolutely to her taste. The severity of the landscape, the clarity of the contours, the light, the color, everything about it was something that appealed to her personally in terms of what she was trying to do as an artist. She captures a feeling about the space, she captures a mood, she captures the essence of what she believed she was seeing in the landscape in New Mexico. She was absolutely in love with it, there's no question.